Let's start at the beginning.
All right. That's when I joined the Marine Corps.
Why did you decide to join?
That's a question that I've had several people ask me. Why did you volunteer? Back in 1942, we were patriots. They attacked us, sneak attacked on us, and I couldn't wait to get in. I wanted to join right after Pearl Harbor, and my dad talked me out. He says, son, wait until after the holidays. We'll make a mess. So then in January, I signed up for Marine Corps, volunteered. I didn't have to be drafted.
How old were you at that time?
21.
So tell me about what happened after you went ahead and enlisted and signed up. What happened from there?
All right. I was sent to San Diego boot camp, and boy, things were tough. This country was in a state of panic. We had bombed, they had bombed Pearl Harbor. We lost the Philippines and some islands, and we were in a state of panic. And man, it was either sink or swim. And we went through boot camp. If you couldn't swim, you sank, and they shipped you home. And they issued me a rifle in there, and that was World War I. Everything they gave me was World War I stuff. We were so unprepared for this war, you can't believe it. And one day they marched down and issued us the bayonet. So I took this bayonet and took it up to the place we were going to clean it with, clean the causaline off of it. And I pulled that out, 16 inches of cold steel. And it was mine to keep and to use. And I looked at that. Well, if that wasn't a wake-up call, what do I do with it? And that was one of many wake-up calls I had in the next 4 years. And then I got through boot camp, and we went right to Hawaii. And then we trained for about a month in Hawaii, and none of us had trained very much. Then we got sent boarded a ship, and we didn't know where we were going. And we went down to New Hebrides Island, and they transferred us on World War I destroyers, rust buckets. Oh, it was just absolutely pathetic back in those days. And so then we went on up and landed on Gaudalcanal. Well, we had a bunch of transports with us, and we got all the guns and all the cartridges and bullets unloaded and some food. Well, when we invaded Gaudalcanal because the Japs were building an airfield on it, and we wanted to stop that, it kind of perturbed the Japs, make them down and run our Navy out. Because they, and our transports had to leave, so they took the food with us, with them, and there we were. Luckily, we had a bunch of Jap rice, and I had fried rice in the morning, fried rice at night, and coconuts. 20 years, I couldn't look a coconut in the eye or look at that rice, see? And we had 10,000, 11,000 Marines landed there, and we had a perimeter 1 mile deep and 5 miles long. An island was 60 miles long, and that's all we had. And then the Japs, they could unload anywhere, and they just kept, mostly defense, they just kept on us all the time. And what are you going to do? Japs on one side and the Pacific Ocean behind us, and America 5,000 miles away. So it was grin and bear it and stay there, wasn't it? Now, you kind of look at your whole card when this happens to you.
What were you thinking at that point?
Well, I thought if I ever got this thing out alive, I'd be lucky. And I made it, see. What saved us, well, luckily we had radar. Radar was just new in those days. And the Japs would bomb us every day with 26 bombers at 26,000 feet. And the radar was good enough that we could tell 25 minutes before they got to the airfield. We was defending the airfield, see. And then we had two batteries of 90-millimeter anti-aircraft guns there with radar control. We had the latest guns and everything. And
where did you end up?
We would shoot, and they weren't very accurate because when they were bouncing around up there, you know, once they release their bombs, if the wing is 5 degrees off, when the bomb hits 5 miles below, it's a long ways off, you know. So you never knew where the doggone bombs was going to be. See? But when you still see those 26 bombers coming, they all look like they're right straight over you. And you sit there waiting what's going to happen, see.
So when one was, you said they look all right straight after you. So every time you'd see one, did you clench down? I mean, what was your reaction to that?
We couldn't see there's 5 miles up, and we couldn't see them release the bombs. See, but we didn't have the type of glasses to see them. See, and the artillery people knew exactly where the release point was. They had that figured out. That's when they started shooting, and it had the concussion would bounce them around a little bit. And when they hit the release point, they hit that, and they weren't straight, and the bombs went straight. Not very many of them hit the runner, and that's what they was aiming at, see.
Did you live in Miller at the time you enlisted, yeah?
No, I was on the farm.
On the farm, where at?
South of Miller. I own that farm now that I was on, or at least my son's own it now, yeah. Well, then, we were helpless. We just had 75-millimeter howitzers and 105s. The Japs had been to shell us tonight. One night, two battleships come in and dropped 950 shells on us, 14-inch shells on our perimeter. And that shook things up. There wasn't anything that could move the next day. They just destroyed everything. And then in November, they relieved the Marines. They had, everybody had yellow jaundice and malaria and sick and wounded, and they relieved us. And the first night out of Gaudalcanal, I was on a Navy transport, and we run into one of our own destroyers. So that laid us up for several days. And then we headed in and left the group. Was going back to States. Otherwise, I'd have went back to States. Left the group and went to one of the New Hebrides Islands, and they repaired the front end of our ship. I do not know whatever happened to that destroyer. When we left it, it was dead in the water. We'd hit her just broadside, see. But when it gets black out there, it's black. You can't see your hand before your face, see. And then eventually, I got yellow jaundice and malaria at the same time. That just about did me in. And then I wound up in hospital in New Zealand, and then they shipped me to San Diego. And I was in hospital in San Diego. When I got out of there, I went back up to Santa Ana, California, where my outfit was, and rejoined them again.
Did you want to rejoin them?
Oh, yes. Yeah. You bet. And then I'm a doggone, and we didn't go back overseas. And that's the time we took the Marshall Islands. But I have a little curious incident that happened on Guadalcanal. We had a young kid with us. He was only 17 years old. He was a fine young man. And he was absolutely fearless. And we were assigned an area to hunt snipers. So he had the lead, and then I was second and a sergeant behind us. And we had come to little clearings of waist-high grass that was so thick and baggy, tangled, you couldn't hardly walk through it. And he'd go through it, and he'd fall down, and he was cussing and making a lot of noise. The sergeant and I kept in the shadows. We didn't want to be silhouetted out there in the bright sun, you know. We didn't know what was out there in the trees. And I kept motioning him to be quiet. Finally, the sergeant motioned to stop. So we went up there and stopped. He stopped under a big tree. And so I walked up there, and I didn't say. I just sat there waiting. And it was 100 degrees out and 100 degree temperature and 100 degrees humidity. And my uniform was stuck to my body by perspiration, you know. And the mosquitoes were further ribboned than it. There's a lot of mosquitoes out there. And when the sergeant came up, I said to him, we called him Termite. I says, Termite? I said, how did you expect to sneak up? And now, these are the exact words. I'll never forget them. I said, Termite, how did you expect to sneak up when these snipers make it? I said, you sound like a bull in a china closet. And he had a real deep voice for a 7-year-old boy. He says, Heilman, he says, you don't know how to hump snipers. He says, my theory is this. Go out here, make a lot of noise, get them to shoot at you. That'll give away the position, then we can get them. Well, it just took me a while to recover from that statement. And I said to him, Termite, what happens if he doesn't miss? Oh, he says, you don't have to worry about that. He says, these Japs are lousy shots. They won't hit you. Well, I said, they might be lousy shots, but some dead Marines down in the beach, I says, Yehudi didn't kill. See, whenever I tell the story, I have to tell them who Yehudi was. See, that was a fictional character that Bob Hope and Jerry Colonna had in his program, they blamed everything on Yehudi. But the new generation, like you, you don't know who Yehudi was. Well, then, I didn't know what to do, and the sergeant said, well, so he wants to let him go. So we finished that hunt without incident. Then I wound up in the hospital in San Diego. And then one day, and somebody comes and says, do you know the termites over in the psychopathic ward? So I didn't know that, so I'll go over there and see him. So I went in there, and there he was, big bars on the windows of this building, and I just walked right in. And there he sat in the cot. Gosh, we shook hands, and after we talked a while and decided what we'd been doing, I says, termites, what are you doing in here? And he had kind of a wistful look, and he looked off the line, blew under, and he says, you know, it's a funny thing. The more I tell these doctors I'm not crazier, the crazier they think I am. Well, I never seen the kid to this day. I don't know. I suppose he made the war. I hope he recovered from that. And I don't know if the kid was shell-shocked or what, but he's just a young boy, and he was absolutely fearless. See.
Are there any other soldiers that you served with that you still see to this day?
They're all dead.
All of them?
Well, I corresponded with four of them. Three of them are dead, and the other one I'm expecting to hear any day that he passed away from Pennsylvania. We just correspond at Christmas time and things like that, see. Well, I'm 87 years old. Well, there's not very many World War II people around anymore, you know. Some of these younger ones went in maybe 17 or 18, but I was 21, see.
Whatever strikes you.
When we left Guadalcanal, we just got out of there, and that was in that famous Navy Sea battle where the South Dakota battleship was involved in it. You've probably read about that. Battleship X, very prominent. And we were just ahead of that. That's when we run into our destroyer, see. And that night or the next night, South Dakota got famous for sinking some Jap ships, see. Yeah. And then I got transferred from the hospital. I come home on furlough and went back to my old outfit and signed up. And I was in like Flynn. That was taking care of that. Now, then we went overseas the second time and went to the Marshall Islands. And that was in February of 44. And you can't believe how in that last year and a half, what happened to this country. We had no protection on Guadalcanal. That's dead soldiers, dead Japs that we buried. We had no way to dig holes for them. We blew it down. But we went over a second time, we were loaded for bear. We had everything. And when we took this island, before we took it, this is what the Navy did to it. They just shot that down on the right and left. Just motor.
Are these pictures that you took?
No, friends of mine. And I was standing next to the guy that took that picture. That was Jap prisoners that was burying their own dead, see, yeah. Now, if you'll notice, there's a bunch of Marines right along this tree line. See these X's? That's no man's land. And I can't remember, I see the patrol going out or coming back. Now, if you don't really think that's exciting duty, go out in the bush where you don't know where the enemy's at, that's exciting, just like this. Going across, just even on your tummy, you don't know what's out there ahead of you.
And you see that as exciting, not scary?
Well, you got your rifle out here, and you got the safety off, and you're drinking, you're putting your heart back in your mouth, and you lift it in. Yeah, I guess you used to call that scary. Yeah. And we buried. I think she's got the pictures in there yet that where we buried these Japs. And the Navy just did a fantastic job of shelling them, and they killed probably more Japs than we did. And but it was just a small island. And we buried 3,500. And they laid out in the sun for 5 to 7 days, 8 days. And you just don't know what war is. this Beltway commandos, you know, to invade this, invade that. They haven't a clue what happens when you get out there, see? The blood and guts, as you say, is just true. And then, after we come back from the Marshall Islands, we was on Roy and Namur.
Oh, really?
And that's Kwajalein Atoll. I was transferred to the East Coast, down in North Carolina, and we were training Marines. I was a gunnery sergeant then. We were training Marines for invasion of Japan. And in the meantime, I had gotten married. My wife was teaching school. I gotten married, and I wasn't anxious to go overseas again. And they come in, and here I was scheduled for my third trip, and was I glad to see Harry Truman when he dropped that atomic bomb. Boy, that was one of my happiest days of my life. And that was it. And I spent, I was in the Marines 4 years, and I spent probably most of the last year in the States enjoying life and discharged and come back to South Dakota.
When the atomic bomb was dropped, you were prepared to go into Japan, weren't you?
Yes. Yes, we're training Marines. And we'd take them out and put them on this old Liberty ship and go out in the ocean and put them in Higgins boats and go into the Cape Hatteras area and unload and go back again. There's training how to do it, see? Hit this point and hit that point, see? And we was ready to invade Japan. And this other lady said some of her relatives was a nurse, and they were all lined up to go over there. And I don't know, a lot of people don't realize this, that I think probably the luckiest thing that happened to Japs is we dropped the bomb on them. Because the Marine Corps, we had about four divisions in, was in a frame of mind that we were mad. They were sneak attacked in Pearl Harbor and the way they treated it. And and then when we, if we'd have gotten there, there was a prisoner of war camp on the southern tip where we landed. Well, see, the Emperor of Japan had ordered all prisoners to be killed if they were invaded. And a lot of people didn't know that. And there was about 140,000 men there, Spanish, or not Spanish, American, Australian, and English. And they'd have got ashore and found where those prisoners all slaughtered, we'd have killed every Jap we saw. That's just all there is to it. That's war. And then, see, they trained the women with sharpened bamboo. Fools ever see a sharpened bamboo hard pull? That's just like steel. And they was going to rush at us. Well, what are you going to do? You're going to shoot them. And after 65 years, you know, I couldn't look at a Jap there for years. I couldn't look at fried rice. I couldn't look at coconuts for 20 years, but you mellow over the years. I get along with the Japs now, but it was sure tough duty doing it.
Some people have called this war the good war. Do you agree?
There's never a good war, but we were attacked. What are you going to do? See, what perturbs me is, and after, as I think I said, I wanted to volunteer, people says, well, why would you volunteer? Well, my God, this is America, and we were attacked, and we were patriots. I couldn't get in there to fight the enemy fast enough. And then they have some nitwit come by and say, why would you volunteer? What's happened to this country? That perturbs me. And what really perturbed me is we got a group there, Miller and us Marines, all on honor guard. And we have honor guard for schools and things, and memorial and stuff like that. And the people don't know what flag etiquette is. They sit on their haunches going by, won't stand up. The older guys will stand up and maybe salute the flag. The rest of them don't.
Yeah, we're
that just perturbs us. And I have people tell me that they're embarrassed of the flag. Well, now, if you are embarrassed of a flag, I suggest you find another flag someplace else. That's kind of a crude thing to say, but that's the way I feel.
You fought for that flag.
Yes. Yes.